Thank you all for staying a little longer for this web extra. I appreciate it. The DOJ report, as I don't have to tell you, is very critical of some of the issues Nancy brought up about people who encountered the police and they had a mental illness, or they were delusional, or they had mental disabilities and they could not comply, or they could not do what the officer wanted. Frustration ensues. Unfortunately, a number of these ended in violence. They're laid out in the DOJ report. So I guess, Lieutenant St. Ange, there's a lot of training taking place. Why is that training perhaps not reaching these officers that were pointed out in this report who went to the taser or went to a gun?
You know, I don't know if I can directly speak to those because I wasn't there. I don't know if the officer had the CIT training. So, you know, what was identified was there were uses of forces. You know, could there have been more training? You know, obviously it's spelled out and, you know, that's what we're striving for is better training.
And so talk about cases where you think perhaps this has worked, where their training, they put their training to use and we didn't see something end in violence.
Gosh, I mean, you look at the hundreds and hundreds of police calls for service that happen every day throughout Albuquerque. One that we just talked about was a junior officer just a few weeks ago encountered I think it was the one on I-40. A junior officer had just taken the CIT certification class the week before and sat there and talked to this gentleman for, I think, over 3 hours, which is in itself mentally exhausting. And was able
this guy was going to jump off a bridge, right?
Correct.
Onto the
interstate, and de-escalated him. And that's proof and a measurable goal that, you know, this training is working. This training is valuable for police officers.
Can I ask you, do the SWAT, the tactical teams also get this?
I believe
they
so.
They get extra training, yeah.
Okay.
I believe they get
tactical get
because they were, you know,
they get the CIT.
They were referred to a lot in the DOJ report, and I wasn't sure in terms of how your team, you know, rolls up on a situation, how you interact with SWAT, and there's a very escalated situation going on.
Well, it wouldn't necessarily be my team, per se.
Okay.
If there is
Should it be?
Well, actually, the team that goes out, they're called CNT, Crisis Negotiations Team. That's more for barricaded subjects. It's actually a higher form of CIT. That's specifically designed for barricaded subjects or individuals, hostage situations. And CNT training is... like another 120 hours of training that they get. You get basic, intermediate, and then advanced. And then you can go on to get a national certification.
Yeah. Okay.
So.
Dr. Rosenbaum,
yes.
I'm just curious, as you train these officers, I'm curious what their reaction is maybe as things start to click. It maybe not happen for everyone, but like, I understand. Okay.
I think the vast majority of the officers I work with do want to learn the best ways to communicate with people who are struggling with mental illness. And sometimes it does give them that, like what you're saying, that light bulb of, oh, this is not as hard as I thought it was. Because I think what people, there's a lot of fear and stigma around mental illness. And so if that's all you've grown up with, I mean, this is long before that someone comes into an academy, that our whole society stigmatizes people with mental illness. And if it just takes the right person to say, just talk to them like, you know, like a normal person. And then the light bulb goes off and then you can prevent a tragedy just by that. So it's not just one person standing up and training by dictum. It's really all the officers working together and learning from each other.
It is super frustrating that you're talking about talking to someone for, how long did you talk to him? 3 hours?
I believe three hours.
That is hard work.
Yeah, it is hard
work. And it can be emotionally and mentally frustrating for the officer.
When they do, generally when they do these long call-outs with CNT, like the SWAT team, like what you see in the movies, there's a whole team. So there's one person who's doing the talking, but there's someone else saying, say this or say that or try this tact. And so they have a whole team and they keep track of things that the person gets angry about or upset about or things that can draw them into the conversation. So there's literally like a board on the wall saying, talk about this, talk about this, try this.
Do you think, I mean, I'm just going by some of the DOJ comments that perhaps not everyone in the department understands the efficacy of what you're trying to do.
The efficacy.
Of doing this kind of very hard, long, patient work, and instead of you know, coming in perhaps with a lot of military gear, which a lot of departments have now. I guess, do you think there's needs to be a cultural shift to understand the importance of what you all are doing?
No, I see what you're asking, and I think it's very hard because it goes back to what we were talking about earlier, is that the police are there to respond to an active shooter in a school.
Okay.
And if there's an active shooter in a school, you want the police to come. You don't want them at the house tied up talking to
somebody. Right. Well, that
suicidal.
Is obviously a
But no, but I'm
but
saying
it's not
so,
always that bad.
No, of course not. But they have to be prepared for the very, very worst to the mundane. And so I agree that they do need to have all that preparation. And so to have all that training to end equipment, you have to have a lot of training, which I think, and it, you have to have the right people in the right place. I think everybody that I've ever worked with at the department doesn't want people to get shot. They don't want people with mental illness to get hurt. It's a tragedy. It's something horrible. And we all really want to make this community better. The cops don't want to get hurt, and they don't want to hurt anybody. These are good people. And I think what happens is that the culture is they look after each other, just like any group does, just like doctors looked after each other. And everybody looks after each other, and I think it gets mislabeled.
And if I could add to that, I think there's sometimes a perception that many of these people are resistant to being assisted with services.
The people who have mental health.
The
issues.
People that have mental health. And there probably is a slice like that. But for many, many of them, the services really, truly don't exist. And a big piece of that is housing, that many of them are not in a stable housing situation where they're able to really maintain the kind of structure that their lives might require to maintain their stability, to maintain their medication, to maintain their meet their basic needs. And they spiral down and out of control. And it's not that they're resistant to having those kind of services available. For most, the vast, vast majority of them, those services really don't exist in our community, and particularly the supportive housing. And some of them probably need, perhaps at least for a temporary period of time, a higher level even from supportive housing, something with 24/7 supervision, but that's less than inpatient care. And we don't have that either.
That costs less than inpatient care.
It costs much less than inpatient care. And it does not exist in our community. And the supportive housing is available, but waiting lists are incredibly long, 7-8 months. And sometimes with this population, you have a window of opportunity to connect with them. And they're not going to be on a waiting list for 8 months, and then you're able to call them and say, hey, we finally have a spot for you. You really have to act when you've had contact with them and they're open to it.
Nancy, the DOJ report, the shootings, focused a lot of attention on these issues. So will we see the kinds of support that you all are talking about and changes in terms of mental health services, perhaps a crisis center? Are you optimistic that this process could be a catalyst?
We have to be hopeful. We've got to be hopeful. Otherwise, having this discussion or doing the work that we do wouldn't make any sense. I think there are several pieces at play. I mean, of course, we've got the legislative session coming up.
But with less money available.
With less money available and for everybody. It would be nice if there could be some behavioral health money identified there. We've got the significant change in the behavioral health system, Medicaid, that's gone through two steps, and we, in terms of the takeover a year and a half ago, and then the change to Centennial Care in January, and that's still rough around the edges. The good part of that is there's Medicaid expansion, so some of the people who are these very people who were not Medicaid eligible before, in theory, should be. So how do we get those people connected to Medicaid so that they could be connected to services? The county has said that the county is going to be spending money, particularly for the supportive housing project that Lisa has been working on. The city has recently voted to spend, I think it's a little over $1 million on as yet undefined set of behavioral health services. So like because of what's happened in the community and how bad things got, there seems to be this window. I mean, really, it is a window of opportunity, and hopefully we can, the trick is going to be, one, getting all of those promises kept, and then two, which is always the biggest piece in any community, how to integrate them, how to get the pieces talking to one another so that there can be soft handoffs, that there can be opportunities. So it's getting the system, getting the services, getting them connected, and trying to have the services be there and through mental health and other support services, so it doesn't have to be a police activity.
I will, yeah, I noted that they had to overcome a lot of silos in San Antonio to make that work.
Right.
So, well, thank you all for staying a little longer to talk about this.